Welcome dear students, welcome to the Medical Globe. This is Dr. Hadi here and today's topic is about disaccharides. Especially, yes, it is the topic of oligosaccharides, but inside oligosaccharides the most important is disaccharides. So let's discuss disaccharides first. A disaccharide is when two monosaccharides, let's suppose you have one monosaccharide and this is another monosaccharide. Two monosaccharide, when these two monosaccharide combine together, we will get another sugar. This is called as disaccharide. Okay. There are many examples of disaccharides like sucrose, maltose, lactose, which will be mentioned on the whiteboard, which will be discussed. But the most important one is the sucrose. Okay, how a sucrose is formed? A sucrose is formed by the combination of glucose and fructose. Remember, glucose is a monosaccharide, fructose is also a monosaccharide. You can watch me, you can see this whole lecture in one of my video lecture with the name of classification of carbohydrate. So glucose and fructose when combined, it will give us sucrose. How? This is the structure of glucose and this is the structure of the fructose. Glucose is a 6-carbon aldehydic sugar. Here alpha D glucose. Why we use the word alpha? Because this is a kind of enomers. You can also see my video lecture on the enomers. So why it is called alpha? Because at carbon number one, the OH is below the plane. Whenever at carbon number one, not carbon number two, three, four, five, when at carbon number one, the OH is below the plane, we call it alpha sugar. And when OH is above the plane, it is called as beta sugar. So here the sugar, we use the word alpha with the glucose, and now it is D-glucose. Why it is D-glucose? Because we have already discussed this in my previous videos, that there are two types of glucose or sugar. One is D-sugar, one is L-sugar. The D-sugar is when the OH group at carbon number 5 comes on the right side, we call it D glucose or D sugar, and when that OH comes on the left side, we call it L glucose. So here in the ring form, we can't mention it, I can't exactly tell you. I have to write the open structure of glucose and then you will get this, how the OH is on the right and left side. But carbon number one and carbon number two, you can write here H above the plane and OH below the plane. At carbon number 3, you have to take care OH will be above and H will be below. At carbon number 4, OH below the plane and H above the plane. Carbon number 5, only H is there. Its OH is being used here with carbon number 1. So C1, C5 make a bond. That is why it is a ring form. You can also watch my another video where I have discussed how glucose form ring structure. And this is carbon number 6, right? So 6 carbon combined to give us alpha D glucose. And this one is another 6 carbon monosaccharide. But this is not 6 cornered. It is 5 cornered. Corner does not, you can't count the number of carbon. You can count corners only. 1 corner 2 3 4 5. So 5 corner is called a furane and 6 corner is called as pyrene. So this is fructose, and we use the word beta because in this time the OH of the carbon number 2, remember alpha and beta sugar, the enomeric carbon in case of glucose is carbon number 1 and in case of fructose the enomeric carbon is carbon number 2. So here the OH is above the plane and we use the word beta D fructose, and you know very well what is D fructose. Here the number of carbon is very important. Carbon number 1 is here. Carbon number 2 is here. Carbon number 3 is here. Carbon number 4 and 5. And this one is carbon number 6. Carbon number 1 and carbon number 6 are out of the ring, while the remaining 4 carbons are inside the ring. So now what will happen? Whenever two monosaccharides, they come close together, a bond will be formed, a kind of reaction will occur, which is called as condensation reaction, that the OH of the carbon number 2 here, this OH, and at carbon number 1, this OH, these two OH will be consumed to form a bond. Anyone from this OH, if the whole OH group is removed and from this only hydrogen will be removed, I repeat, from one of the OH, the full complete OH group will be removed, and from other OH only the hydrogen will be removed. And what will happen, that if I, let's suppose I remove this whole OH, I remove this whole OH, and now what will happen, that this carbon which had four bonds previously has now 1, 2, 3 bonds. It is now electron deficient, so a positive charge will develop on carbon number 2. Okay, now from this only the hydrogen will be removed. The hydrogen will be removed. Only the hydrogen will be removed. And what happened when the hydrogen is removed? This oxygen will get a negative charge when it expel out the hydrogen. Now it is electron rich and carbon number 2 is electron deficient, electron poor. What will happen? This oxygen will make a bond with carbon number 2, and this bond is called as glycosidic bond. Remember that now the carbon number 2 has again 4 bonds, 1, 2, 3, 4, it is okay, carbon number 2 is now okay. So this bond will be shown here like this. Here is oxygen, and this oxygen will make a bond with carbon number 2. And this carbon number 2, its CH2OH is now, I have just mentioned it above the plane. Okay, fine. And here the hydrogen still will be present here. So now look at that bond between the two bond that we have oxygen, this kind of bond is called as glycosidic bond, right? You can write HOH, it is now not necessary to write again HOH, okay, CH2OH, it's fine. Now the most important thing is that how the two monosaccharides are combined together. Now this bond which is formed, how we will name it? It is named as alpha arrowhead beta. Alpha because the carbon number 1, this is alpha sugar and that is beta sugar. So we write alpha arrowhead towards beta, alpha beta 1 arrowhead 2. Means carbon number 1 is linked with carbon number 2. So here we write 1, 2 glycosidic bond. This is most important, that the bond in the sucrose is alpha beta 1, 2 glycosidic bond. Okay, this was the formation of sucrose, and I hope that once any student get the idea of this bond formation, he or she will be able to understand in advance the bond formation in other disaccharides like maltose and lactose. Here is one more point. Sucrose is non-reducing. Why? Reducing sugar, as already we have discussed, that those sugar that can give its electron to others, mean that can reduce others. So any monosaccharide, if you take, they are reducing sugar. And any disaccharides, all disaccharides are reducing except one disaccharide, this one. Sucrose is not reducing. Why it is not reducing? Because for a sugar to have reducing property, that sugar must contain a free aldehyde group or a free ketonic group. But in this case, okay, the condition for reducing property is the glucose must contain free aldehyde dic group or free ketonic group. In case of aldehydic sugar, the carbon number one contains C double bond O, carbon number one. In case of ketonic sugar, carbon number two contains C double bond O, right? So these the carbon which contain double bond O, we will name them as a free aldehydic or ketonic groups. In case of glucose, which is an aldehydic sugar, its carbon number one is busy, is engaged, so it is not free. Now you can't expect that it will give its electron, it will reduce others. And in case of ketonic sugar, as fructose is a ketonic sugar, and in case of fructose, the carbon number two is called a free ketonic group. So carbon number two is also linked, is also busy. Both the two carbons are linked, busy. So you cannot expect that this sugar will reduce some other compound. So that is why sucrose is not reducing. And other disaccharides like maltose, if let me write maltose, so I will raise this now, will write maltose. For maltose, I can only erase this one. Okay, everything will be same. In case of maltose, you can have again same alpha D glucose, and it will link with another alpha D glucose. So I will write another one more sugar like this. Okay, like this. Okay. This is one more sugar. Okay, here we'll write carbon number one, and here is oxygen. Carbon number five, CH2OH. You can now name them as carbon number one, carbon number two, carbon number three, carbon number four, carbon number five, and carbon number six, just like this, okay? H and OH, H OH, H OH, H OH. Here, at carbon number five, only H will be there because its OH is already busy with C1 and C5. Now what will happen again? We got two monosaccharides. This time these two both are alpha D glucose. Alpha D glucose, alpha D glucose. What will happen again? These two OH group will be consumed in the bond formation. One of the OH will be removed completely. So I will remove this OH along with the bond. Along with the bond, this OH will be removed completely. So here the carbon which had four bonds is now having three bonds. So it will be having a positive charge, and this OH, it will remove only its hydrogen. As a result of removal of hydrogen, it will get a negative charge, because hydrogen will be kicked out without its electron. The electron of hydrogen will be positioned, will be occupied, will be possessed by this oxygen, and the hydrogen will be removed as a H positive ion. Here the OH was removed completely in the form of OH minus. So these two, OH minus and H plus, they will combine and they will make H2O. So H2O will be released. Now what will happen? As I mentioned, this oxygen will make a bond with carbon, and we get another structure. I think there is no need to write once again, because we will, a lot of time will be consumed here. So I will write here now this one and this one. Okay, again a bond is being now formed. Now this is another disaccharide. This is another disaccharide in front of us. So another disaccharide, and this disaccharide is called as maltose. This is called as maltose. What is the name of this? This will, we call it alpha 1 arrowhead 4 glycosidic bond. Glycosidic bond. So this is most important. In the previous structure, in case of sucrose, the bond was 1,2, but in case of maltose, the bond is alpha 1,4 glycosidic. 1,4 because carbon number 1 is linked with carbon number 4. That's why we use alpha 1,4. Now, is maltose also reducing? So we say yes, it is reducing. It is non-reducing. It is not non-reducing. It is reducing. Why? Because we know that both are aldehydic sugar, and in aldehydic sugar, the carbon number 1 is always a free aldehydic group. So this carbon number 1 is busy with carbon number 4. Okay, fine, it's okay. But if you come here, this is also aldehydic sugar. Its carbon number 1 is free. This carbon number 1 is called as free aldehydic group. So they, because of this carbon number 1, because of free carbon number 1, maltose is still reducing sugar. It can reduce other. It can form ozazone. It can form ozazone, so it can reduce. Now, if you take another disaccharides, lactose, I will not write the structure. It will be given as an assignment to you people. Whenever you're sitting at home or you're at your class, you must write by yourself what will be the structure of the lactose, where we see that in the lactose, the one is glucose plus galactose. These two will combine and it will give us lactose. Glucose plus galactose. Now what will you do? This is your assignment. Write the structure of glucose. Which glucose? Alpha D glucose. And which galactose? Alpha D galactose. You can write this galactose and glucose, combine them, make a bond, and you will get lactose. Okay, once we got the three structure, the three disaccharides, sucrose, maltose, and lactose. Now we'll come to some important things that I brought, is the cellobiose. What is cellobiose? Cellobiose is there is a voice outside my room. It's just a road, so I hope you will not be disturbed from this. Okay, cellobiose is a disaccharide. It's just like a disaccharide. If you write it here, okay, it's a disaccharide. The disaccharide. But it contain what? Beta-1,4. Cellobiose. Beta-1,4. As you know that in maltose, there is alpha-1,4 linkage. Alpha-1,4 in maltose. But if it is beta-1,4, it will be called as cellobiose, right? And the cellobiose always come from the cellulose. It will always come from the cellulose. Cellulose is a polysaccharide. We will discuss it in my next lecture. And then we have another is isomaltose. What is isomaltose? Okay, isomaltose. Okay, what is isomaltose? In isomaltose, if you come to maltose, in maltose we saw that in maltose there are two glucose, and in between the two glucose there is alpha 1,4 linkage. But in isomaltose, if the bond is alpha 1,6, means one sugar's carbon number 1 and other sugar's carbon number 6 is utilized. So when alpha 1,6 bond is there, it will be called as isomaltose. Good. Third one is sucralose. From sucrose to sucralose. A sucrose, but this sucrose contain 1,2,3. According to the book of Satya Narayan, sucralose is trichlorosucrose. Trichlorosucrose is called as sucralose. It is called as the artificial sweetener. It is called as the artificial sweetener. Why? Because it will give you the taste 500 times more sweeter than the sucrose. Sucrose is a disaccharide that we use at home, is a table sugar you use in tea. Everyone is well aware of this. It's very famous disaccharide, sucrose, and the white sugar we use. So it is 500 times, according to the book of Satyanarayana, it is 500 times more sweeter than the sucrose. And that's why it's called as artificial sweetener, and it is very suitable for the patient of diabetic, because it cannot consume in your body. It will give you the taste, but it will not consume in your body, because diabetic patient don't like sugar. So diabetic patient can use sucralose to have a taste, sweet taste, right? Then we have the last one is the lactose and lactulose. Okay, stay with me. This is just last topic, that is lactulose. Okay, a lactulose is combination of galactose plus fructose. Galactose plus fructose. When these two are combined, we will get another disaccharide called as lactulose. And do you know lactulose is very important medically? I have mentioned medical importance of the disaccharides. This is why it is very important, because of two reasons. Number one, it is used in hepatic encephalopathy. And second, to treat constipation. Two conditions are there in which we can use the lactulose. One is the hepatic encephalopathy, and second one is the constipation. First come to hepatic encephalopathy. What is hepatic encephalopathy? In which the level of the ammonia is increased in your body, NH3, ammonia. NH3 is very toxic. When it increases in your body, it will cause hepatic encephalopathy. So what will we do in your intestine? We add lactulose. What it will do? If your intestine get NH3, means if you get NH3 from somewhere, you add lactulose. Lactulose will give one more hydrogen to it, and it will convert NH3 into NH4 plus NH4. Now this is called ammonium ion. NH3 is called ammonia, NH4 is called ammonium ion. Ammonium ion cannot leave your intestine to come into the blood, because it is the intestine where things will enter into the blood. So it will not allow the ammonium ion to enter into the blood, and this is all because of the lactulose. So most of the ammonia will remain in your intestine, and it will be excreted in your feces. So the level of ammonia will not increase in the blood. So this is the first uses of the lactulose. Second is constipation. In constipation, once again, we are focusing towards your large intestine. This is your large intestine. In large intestine, you know, in constipation, we need to have some water in intestine so that it can give bulk, it gives some soothness to the food material. So that again, the food or the feces can have some movement. And once the movement is started, there will be no constipation. So we are concerned with the movement. The bowl of the food which is present here, that is the food or the feces, if there is no water, let's suppose there is no water, it will be dry form, it will be kind of a dryness will be there, and it can't move further ahead because no water is there. What we do, we give lactulose. Now let's suppose this is the lactulose. Okay. When you add lactulose is very special in a sense that once they come into intestine, they will not be absorbed. They can't absorb. They can't leave your intestine. They will remain intestine. They will not absorb. This is the speciality. So what it will attract water through its osmotic action. So from the blood, it will attract water. Here is water. So when water is attracted because of the lactulose, this water, there is a chance that this water make the food, the feces, a bit softer, and the soft food can now travel very easily through the intestine, and the problem of constipation is overcome. That was all the topic about the disaccharides. I hope you got you understand my topic. Please keep me remember in your prayers. Have a good smile on your face. Thank you and bye bye.